This episode of Real Engineering is brought to you by Brilliant, a problem-solving website that teaches you to think like an engineer. Many climate stabilization plans depend upon the power sector moving towards net zero carbon dioxide output by 2050. To achieve this, fossil fuel power plants are beginning to close around the world. Coal, the world's staple energy source for centuries, has steadily fallen out of favor since 2015, with a 70% drop in new construction projects. This decline cannot be entirely pinned on shifting global attitudes to climate change. Economic pressures have been the driving force for many of the closures, as solar and wind energy continues to get cheaper. California is among the most proactive places in the world when it comes to renewable energy, and they have a good reason to be. Droughts and wildfires have plagued the state in recent years, and trends indicate that they will continue to get worse with increasing global temperature. Over the past 8 years, Californian energy sources have shifted dramatically. In 2010, their energy sources looked like this, with the majority of energy coming from natural gas, hydroelectricity, nuclear, and geothermal. In 2018, each of these energy sources has dropped in the percentage of total energy production, with solar rising to an astounding 19% in just 8 years, and wind more than doubling to 6.5%. Last year, Californian lawmakers set a goal of reaching 100% renewable energy for the state by 2045, and at this rate, California are on track. But California's progress is about to get a lot more expensive and difficult, as switching to 100% renewable energy, even in sunny California, is not quite as easy as installing solar panels. Let's discover why by visiting Moss Landing in beautiful Monterey Bay. This natural gas power plant began producing energy in 1950 with a nameplate power capacity of 613 megawatts. By 2002, it was the largest power plant in the state of California with a power capacity of 2,560 megawatts. It has gone through many changes in those 70 years of operation, with older, less efficient systems being retired and replaced with modern, more efficient and cleaner systems. Last year, the latest update for the facility was announced with an unprecedented battery storage facility totaling 567 megawatts of storage, making it the largest battery installation in the world. This battery storage facility is designed to take over the Moss Landing power plant's role as a peaker station, providing surges of energy to the grid when needed, and thus decrease California's use of natural gas. California's grid operator provides live and historical stats on power generation and consumption. Let's take a look at a typical day in the state. This is the energy supply for May 24th, 2018. This line is the power gained from hydroelectricity. We can see a steady baseload is provided by nuclear energy from the Diablo Canyon power plant, which is this flat output line. This supply deviates very little throughout the year, providing a steady 2,280 megawatts, about 9% of the needs of the state. This power station rarely varies its load because it takes a tremendous amount of time to do so. Here we can see the very noticeable spike of renewable energy starting at 6 a.m. as the sun rises. On this day, 34.5% of California's electricity was provided by renewable energy, 51% of that being from solar. This is fantastic, but we have one big problem. Solar energy began to drop off at 5 p.m. Just as California's population was about to leave work and get stuck in traffic for hours before arriving home to turn on their air conditioning, cook their dinners, and watch TV. This results in a peak power demand at 8:30, 4.5 hours after our solar supply peaked. In order to deal with this demand, California begins to ramp up its natural gas power stations, which can quickly raise their energy output to deal with surges in demand. California also imported a significant amount of energy from other states, primarily wind and hydroelectricity from the Pacific Northwest and nuclear, coal, and natural gas from Nevada. As California looks towards a carbon-neutral energy supply, they are looking to remove these natural gas power stations and replace them with batteries that can store excess solar electricity so it is available when needed. This battery installation in Moss Landing is going to fill that role. And make no mistake, batteries are now cheap enough to be a financially viable solution for California at small scales like this, allowing power companies to buy cheap solar energy and sell it on for a profit when demand requires. However, this business model does not last very long as we scale up. Let's calculate how much battery storage California would need to replace just this natural gas peaking power on May 24th, 2018. Step 1, download the data from this day and graph the natural gas power output. This data has a resolution of 5 minutes, but we are going to reduce our resolution to an hour to make the data easier to parse. We will assume our new grid will contain a steady base load of natural gas power at 4,220 megawatts, which is a 10% drop in our natural gas use for the day and a 1.7% drop when expressed as a percentage of total energy use on the day. In an ideal world, I think California would be generating this base load using nuclear energy, but that seems unlikely as early last year, regulators voted to close the Diablo Canyon power plant, California's last nuclear power plant. We can now clearly see the energy we need to provide with batteries, as this area that rises above our base load. To calculate it, we simply need to calculate the area of this section, which will give us our battery storage requirements in megawatt hours. This comes out to be about 11,200 megawatt hours of energy storage. Tesla's 129 megawatt hour battery storage facility for Hornsdale Farm in Australia came with a price tag of $56 million. Extrapolating that figure out to an 11,200 megawatt hour battery, we could expect a total cost of $4.86 billion. We would likely be able to achieve a lower battery cost over time as battery prices continue to lower over time. It's not an absurd number. Diablo Canyon Power Plant, which has about 5 times the daily energy output, cost $13.8 billion to construct. However, it's important to remember that batteries do not generate their own energy, and in order to make this a worthwhile endeavor, renewable energy would need to generate a surplus of electricity during the day to charge them, which California is already doing. Every day, California curtails significant amounts of renewable energy which is not needed. This figure is continually rising, with April 2019 having a record 190,000 megawatt hours wasted. On May 7th of this month, an astounding 8,369 megawatt hours was curtailed, nearly enough to fully charge our massive battery. It's this cheap energy our Moss Landing battery farm will be looking to purchase and sell for a profit. However, going forward to May 15th, just 193 megawatt hours was curtailed. Even in summer, our renewable resources are highly variable and unreliable. This leaves us vulnerable if we do not have alternative energy sources like natural gas or nuclear to pick up the slack. But let's move forward assuming we are going to rely on solar as Californian politicians seem to be aiming for. This requires billions of dollars to be spent building redundant power which can pick up the slack when needed. This problem becomes particularly apparent in January and December, where our energy generation falls off a cliff, even in sunny California. Let's analyze the Topaz Solar Farm to see the scale of our problem. In order for solar energy to reliably provide power, we need to size it to give us the necessary power even in winter months. Once again, we have all the data we need to figure this out. Here is the average energy output for a single day of each month over the past 4 years of this farm's operation. As we can see, our energy generation drops from a peak of 4,388 megawatt hours in June to a low of 2,637 megawatt hours in January. This differential is actually quite good, and other solar farms can see a larger drop in production, but for now, we will be generous. So, to charge our 11,200 megawatt hour battery using this power source in winter, we would need a solar farm 4.25 times bigger than Topaz Farm. This solar farm cost $2.4 billion to construct, so, once again, scaling linearly, we could expect a cost of $10.2 billion for a solar farm of this size. Now, this presents a new problem. At our peak power in summer, we are generating on average an excess of 7,437 megawatt hours a day. If this energy cannot find a home, grid operators have to shut it down to prevent it from overloading the grid. To prevent the energy being curtailed, it can be exported, assuming neighboring states are also not overproducing. Or we can add more storage to the grid, which would cost roughly $3.2 billion using the same method of estimation from earlier. You can see a pattern emerging here. To increase solar, we need to add more batteries. In order to add more batteries, we need to add more solar, and it eventually gets to a point where batteries dominate costs. costs explode as we increase our reliance on renewable energy and storage. Here, to just increase our renewable resources by 1.9 to maybe 2.5%, we have reached a total estimated cost of $18.26 billion. $4.6 billion more than the construction cost of Diablo Canyon Nuclear Power Station while producing less power. These costs bloat more and more as we increase our reliance on renewables. In order to ensure we have enough power in the winter months, we have to build excessive amounts of renewable energy sources, or we can try to store the excess power from the summer months and save it for a rainy day, at which point our costs become dominated by batteries. The Clean Air Task Force, an MIT research group, estimated that California would require 9.6 million megawatt hours of energy storage at 80% renewable usage, and 36.3 million megawatt hours of energy storage at 100%. This is equivalent to 12 days and 45 days worth of energy storage, respectively. Their rationale for this, which is not clearly given in any of their documentation, but I managed to track down the original researcher, is that this is the storage required to store all the excess energy in the summer months when we scale our renewables to be 50% from solar and 50% from wind, while not scaling their power generation to provide enough energy even on the average winter day. A very strange approach considering lithium-ion batteries are not suitable for long-term storage, gradually losing their charge. This, coupled with the costs associated with batteries, along with the rapidly falling price of solar and wind energy, makes me very skeptical of the number. 36.3 million megawatt hours of energy storage, if we gave a generous future adjusted price of $100 per kilowatt hour, would come out at a price of $3.63 trillion, more than the $3 trillion gross domestic product of California for 2018. This, for me, is an oversimplistic approach. So, let's set forth our own plan, taking January of this year as an example. We are going to scale our power for this month, as it's our worst case scenario. Downloading the data for every single day of the month, we can see the energy demand per day varying like so. Now, if we place our solar generation on the same graph, we can see it generated an average of 8.2% of our total generation, with a low of 2.1% on January 4th and a high of 12.7% on January 27th. We had consecutive bad days on the 14th, 15th, 16th, and 17th, with only 2.1%, 2.2%, 5.2%, and 3% from solar. If we scale this to provide 100% of our energy needs, even on our worst day, we can see that the high variation would add additional costs, either in battery storage or excess solar. Thankfully, if we now overlay our wind generation, we can see that on those days, wind generation was higher than normal and picked up the slack a little. These were obviously cloudy, stormy days in California. This raises an important point on California's strategy. They have been rushing to install megawatts of solar in recent years and have not been installing enough wind. Wind may be an overall more expensive power source for California, but going forward, it's going to be a vital part of diversifying their power sources. If we add our other renewable power sources, which are geothermal, biofuels, and small hydro facilities, our new renewables count comes out like this, accounting for an average of 20% of our energy needs. Large hydro facilities are technically a renewable energy source, but are not counted in our total as they require environmentally destructive dams. They are also not counted as they are some of the oldest power stations, and policymakers do not want large hydro facilities watering down their efforts in increasing other renewable sources. For our purposes, this is silly, so let's add it in. Once again, we have smoothed our output, allowing us to be less reliant on batteries and excess power. Closing nuclear stations is also a questionable move, and overall going to add to our grid's costs and inefficiencies. The higher the probability of dips in renewables on consecutive days like this, the more batteries we are going to need to store excess power on other days. That also means we have to install additional excess power sources in order to ensure we have excess power to charge our batteries. This can be done in summer months, but as we said, batteries are not well suited to long-term storage. Thankfully, many companies are working on developing cheaper energy solutions for the grid, which will allow us to cost-effectively store energy. Currently, the true holy grail is developing cheap storage that will be able to store all that excess power in the summer months and allow us to spread it out throughout the year. ARPA-E, an energy research group modeled after DARPA, the lunatics that funded this monstrosity, invested $30 million in 10 startups trying to develop this technology. Some focus on thermal batteries, others thermochemical, and Form Energy, who's developing a sulfur-based battery, received the largest share of that $30 million. These are technologies that could facilitate a smaller, more efficient renewable grid, and we will cover them in a future episode. So, to recap, California is heading towards over-reliance on solar energy. It needs to begin diversifying its renewable portfolio with wind and other sources, continue to slowly build out these lithium-ion battery facilities to replace natural gas peaking power, but unless something dramatically changes, they aren't going to be a panacea to our renewable energy woes. So, continued research into low-cost, long-term energy storage will be vital. ARPA-E needs to be supported in this effort. This is just a brief look at California. But while the parameters of this problem change with different climates and economies, the overall problem is the same. We need every country to be intelligently optimizing their grid to accommodate renewables. To ensure an optimized grid is going to require careful analysis of historical data like we did above, while calculating statistical likelihood of not fulfilling demand with different energy systems. As much as I would love to, performing a complete study of this nature is outside the scope of a YouTube video, but if I was going to do it, I would need to brush up on my Python coding knowledge to automate the process and my understanding of statistics, both of which I could do on Brilliant. Taking these two courses will give you all the skills you need to take large datasets like this and make sense of them. Python is one of the most widely used programming languages, and it is an excellent first language for new programmers. This course will show you how to use Python to create intricate drawings, coded messages, and beautiful data plots, while teaching you some essential core programming concepts. Combine this with the statistics course to learn more about medians, variance, and standard deviation, and you'll have all the skills to make sense of the mountains of data available on grid provider sites like this. Brilliant recently introduced a new feature called Daily Challenges, which will present you with interesting scientific and mathematical problems to test your brain every day. If I've inspired you and you want to educate yourself, then go to brilliant.org/realengineering and sign up for free. And the first 500 people to go to that link will get 20% off the annual premium subscription, so you can get full access to all their courses as well as the entire Daily Challenges archive. As always, thanks for watching and thank you to all my Patreon supporters. If you'd like to see more from me, the links to my Instagram, Twitter, subreddit, and Discord server are below.